on. Hello, my name is Stephanie Raleigh, and I am the department head in landscape architecture and regional and community planning. On behalf of the regional and community planning faculty, I'd like to welcome you to this distinguished lecture given by Thomas Campanella. Tom is an associate professor at Cornell, and he is the director of the Urban and Regional Studies program there. His doctoral work was at MIT, and he holds an MLA from Cornell. He's received a Guggenheim Fellowship, the Rome Prize, and also a Fulbright Fellowship. Tom is truly a thought leader in planning. His essays connect us to places and people and time, and explain the forces that have shaped the places where we live. He's very insightful, and I think especially clever in the way that he writes. Our department has been inspired by the essay that he wrote, The Life and Death of American Planning, which is published in the book, Reconsidering Jane Jacobs. If you haven't had an opportunity to read it, I highly recommend it. It has been a force in the way that we think about our curriculum and the way we talk about the future of planning and also its relationship to landscape architecture. Tom's books include The Concrete Dragon, China's Urban Revolution and What It Means for the World, as well as Republic of Shade, New England and the American Elm. He has a website, builtbrooklyn.org. I'll repeat that because you're going to want to look at it, builtbrooklyn.org, which is a real treasure trove of links to articles and essays that he's written. It's a rabbit hole that you can go down for several hours, so set aside some time and prepare to enjoy yourself. Today, he's going to talk about the origins of the American highway. He's going to unpack the history of a piece of infrastructure that changed our country and the way that we live. So please help me welcome Thomas Campanella.
Thank you. That was very nice. Thank you, Stephanie. I was called insidious yesterday in my introduction, now clever as well, both in a good way. I want to talk about or share with you today a creation story of sorts that about a form of infrastructure that we're all very familiar with, that's ubiquitous around the world, and one that can be traced to a single unlikely source, and to a group of men, and they were all men. At the very forefront of not the automobile industry, nor either the construction industry, as one might think, but the conservation movement. And I'm referring here, as you know, to the modern limited access motorway, the modern highway, and the progenitor of which, really the first of which, from the road from which all other highways in the world share some DNA or derive their DNA in large part, the Bronx River Parkway in Westchester County. The origins of the Bronx River Parkway were here. Here in the, of all places, the New York Zoological Park, the Bronx Zoo, as it's commonly known today. This was formerly known as it was organized and founded by the New York Zoological Society, which I'll say more about in a minute. The Bronx Zoo and the Zoological Society were both institutions, New York institutions, very prestigious institutions, and two of a cluster of similar institutions that focused on conservation, on the study of the natural world, that were founded by and for two generations really dominated by a very elite group of high-born men, well-born men, all Ivy League educated, mostly at Columbia and Harvard and Yale and Dartmouth in one case. And these men all knew each other and shared membership and were involved in many of the same organizations, one of which was the American Museum of Natural History. In fact, many of these animals here that you see, I'm sure many of you have been to this museum. If not, it's worth visiting next time you're in New York City, in the other Manhattan. These animals were, by and large, collected by the same group of men, right? They were mostly hunters. They were all involved with the founding of the Boone and Crockett Club, which still exists. Those of you who are hunters here, I'm sure you know this organization. It maintains lists of trophy game animals and also has now a gift catalog. What organization, institution, does not have tchotchkes for sale? And that's Teddy Roosevelt on the left doing his thing with a black rhino. Here's just, this is a little bit hard to read, and it's not necessary to commit to memory, but you'll see some of the names here repeated again and again under each of these organizations. Teddy Roosevelt, George Grinnell, William Temple Hornaday, Henry Fairfield Osborne, and a person that I want to focus on a bit more than the others, Madison Grant, right? And here's what some of them look like. There's Madison Grant on the left. Henry Fairfield Osborne was arguably the most important president of the American Museum of Natural History, also a big game hunter himself. So was Teddy Roosevelt. Up in the Bronx at the New York Zoological Park, the Bronx Zoo, we had this gentleman here, William Temple Hornaday, who was also a distinguished conservationist. Many of these men were, when they weren't killing animals, they were working very hard to save them, partly so they could shoot them later. Mainly, I don't want to be too flippant about this, mainly because they really felt that something had to be done to stop the rampant exploitation of the natural world, which was really going gangbusters at this time in the United States. This is an era, and we're talking around the turn of the century here, of the 19th century. This is an era when you had the bison being slaughtered by the tens of thousands on the Great Plains. You had the passenger pigeon basically packed off to extinction, in many other, of course, the forests being leveled, and there really was almost no control over for the preservation, in the interest of preservation of the, or conservation of the natural environment. So these men were at the forefront of the American conservation movement. They weren't the only ones, but they were very well connected, they were very powerful, and they had the money and the means to create institutions that did a lot of good. For example, the New York Zoological Society is today the Wildlife Conservation Society, right? It's the same organization. It's grown and morphed, and the group doesn't necessarily underscore its connection to some of these individuals today. But nonetheless, here, Hornaday was very involved with the preservation of the American bison. In fact, many scholars feel that if it wasn't for him, the bison would have been hunted to extinction. I'll try not to do that again. But it was also Hornaday who engaged in less savory activities at the Bronx Zoo, including the imprisonment or caging of human beings as animals, right? You may be familiar with the story of Otabenga, who was an African tribesman who was essentially exhibited as an animal at the Bronx Zoo. And this was largely Hornaday's doing. The whole affair did not last very long. It caused a real scandal. There were protests among the religious communities, by the African American communities across the country. And he was released, so to speak. And a very tragic story, committed suicide not long after this incident. There's been a couple of good books about Otabenga. So these men had somewhat, as you'll see as I get into this a bit more, somewhat problematic views about the human race, even as they were attempting and very effectively to preserve aspects of the natural world. The gentleman on the right here is also part of this group. His name appeared earlier, William White Niles. Niles was an attorney in New York, also from a very wealthy family, was a leading advocate of park, setting aside parks in the Bronx. Many of the large parks in the Bronx today are there because of his advocacy. He served also on the board of directors of the New York Zoological Society and the park itself, the Bronx Zoo. Hornaday was the, I may not have mentioned this, but Hornaday was the first director of the Bronx Zoo. They were good friends. Hornaday was invited to by Andrew Carnegie to visit his castle in Scotland, the Skibo Castle near Inverness. And Niles went with him. Niles was not invited to visit this place. That's actually the lobby of Carnegie's little cottage. But he accompanied Hornaday as far as Inverness. This is an aerial view of Inverness. And what Niles did to kill a couple of days, basically, is walk all over the city. And he was especially interested in the quality of the water of the River Ness as it entered the city toward the bottom of this slide, and what perhaps the waters looked like as they exited the city. And he was very curious to see if, in fact, as he expected, the waters would be fully polluted and foul and stinking upon departure up at the top of the slide there. What he found instead was that wasn't the case. The waters were just as clean exiting the city as they had been entering. And this gives him an idea about what might be done with the little river, more like a creek really, but the Bronx River that flowed down from Westchester County into his native Bronx, which in fact came in as this pristine stream and exited into the Long Island Sound, about as toxic and foul as you can imagine. So bad, and this is where his buddies all get involved and get on board with this idea, so foul that the waters were killing the waterfowl and other animals in the Bronx Zoo, because the Bronx River actually flows through the New York Zoological Park. And at the time, at least, back then, the waters for the various creatures were the water used for the animals was being drawn from this river, right? And so many of them were getting sick and dying. This leads to Niles advocating for, backed by this group of powerful, well-connected, affluent men, conservationists, to restore the Bronx River, right? To reclaim, today we would call it a stream restoration project, an environmental remediation project. That's essentially what Niles advocates. He submits a bill to the state legislature. It's shot down the first round, but it is passed in 1906, signed into law by the governor at the time, Frank Higgins. And you can see there what specifically this law was about. It was, you can read it, to inquire into the advisability of preserving the waters, right, of the Bronx River from pollution and of creating a reservation of the lands on either side. So what we're talking about here is a linear park, right, an open space system, but there's no mention anywhere, right, in this legislation about a road. Right, we all know the Bronx River Parkway today as a road. But it did not begin that way. In fact, the Bronx River Parkway was just that. It was a parkway. It was a linear park, the first linear park in New York City, in fact. So the commission, this three-person commission, is created, and it consists of Madison Grant, who you see up on the upper right again, right? James G. Cannon, who was a Westchester banker, and the fellow in the wonderful straw boater there, Dave Hannon Morris, And I'll say more about Morris in a moment, because he will emerge as a very significant person in this story. There you see William White Niles as the secretary. Now, the chairman of this commission and the person who really took this up with great enthusiasm and pushes it through and sees it to completion to the point where he's commemorated with this medal here, this beautiful table medal by Sinek, Ray Sinek, he was a major sculptor at the time, was Madison Grant. And Madison Grant is one of the more problematic figures in the American conservation movement, but was very successful in preserving, in saving the forests of the Redwood Coast, the American bison. In fact, on the reverse side of this medallion, you see the redwoods very clearly rendered there. You see a bison on the right. On the front here, you see the New York ZS Zoological Society, forebear of today's Wilderness Conservation Society. And you also see very clearly Bronx River Parkway, chairman of the Bronx River Parkway Commission. Madison Grant's interest in the natural world was one that tied very intimately into his sensibility about the human race. He was especially interested in preserving and conserving plants and animals that he saw as the aristocracy of the natural world, right? He was very interested in the North American moose, in the bison, in the redwoods, in the bighorn sheep. These were all animals he liked to hunt too. You know, that's certainly part of this. But these were the nobility to him. These were the aristocracy. And he didn't stop with the natural world. Some of you may recognize his name, Madison Grant's name, as the author of this somewhat problematic book, The Passing of the Great Race. This was one of the most popular books in the first 15, 20 years of the 20th century. It was a bestseller, and it basically laid out his theory of the hierarchy of the human race, of the various races and ethnic groups. And he had no questions as to who was on top here, who were the human equivalents of the moose and the bison and the redwoods. His group of folks, it turns out. Here you see one of the maps in his book here, Passing of the Great Race, and you see here present distribution of the European races. And the Nordics there in red, those are his folks, and the great race in the title of his book. Everyone else is kind of in the basement or cellar or further down. This would all be kind of, you know, racist pablum if it wasn't for the fact that it led to some of the most draconian immigration legislation we've ever had in the United States. Madison Grant was not content to just write racist tracts and then go out hunting. He was a very successful advocate for passing laws that carried into effect his ideas about racial hierarchy. And these resulted in a spectrum of laws that were passed in the early 1920s that really changed the face, literally changed the face of America. The National Origins Act, and a variety of related pieces of legislation essentially closed the doors to immigrants coming into the United States. The National Origins Act, in a nutshell, very deviously looked back to the racial and ethnic mix in the United States circa 1850 or so, and pegged quotas to that. Right, so there were huge quotas allowed for folks from Sweden and England and Germany and the Nordic countries, and very tiny quotas for folks from Italy, say, or Eastern Europe. And in a related piece of legislation, the Chinese were completely excluded, the Chinese Exclusion Act And as you see, this is a New York Times article from the early 20s here, America of the Melting Pot Comes to an End. And this is something that is not rolled back, is not changed until 1965 or so, right, when Manny Queller and Ted Kennedy submit legislation that is passed that basically opens the doors again to immigration from around the world. So Madison Grant sees the problem of this polluted waterway in Westchester and the Bronx, not only through the eyes of an ecologist, a conservationist, and a naturalist, but through the eyes of a racist, right? And someone who has a very judgmental sensibility about the human race and society in general. So he sees this scene here and doesn't just see, oh, this is pollution and untreated sewage being dumped right into the waterway. He sees these houses stocked full of the great unwashed, right? Ethnic groups, a lot of Italians living here, very poor folks, working class folks, and that adds to his impetus, to his desire to literally scrape this clean and dial it all back to some more pristine state. And this really is what leads to the creation of this linear park, the Bronx River Parkway. And again, as I said a moment ago, it is in its initial stages, it is just that. It is a parkway. It is a linear park, a linear open space system. So though you see here, Parkway appears in the name, right, of the commission from the very start, right, it only initially means a linear park. The closest we get to a motorway, right, or road being suggested, it doesn't occur until page 11. And there's this only a tangential mention of potentially using part of this reserved corridor, this Parkway reservation, right, for a boulevard, a European-style avenue like Ocean Parkway or Eastern Parkway in Brooklyn or Riverside Drive in Manhattan. Here's actually that page 11, and you see here proposed sanitary reservation, and there may be an opportunity for a direct level and attractive boulevard connecting Westchester down into the city. That's the extent of any mention of a road, right, and it isn't even framed in the sense of being a state-of-the-art automobile road, which of course it becomes. And you see in the early maps here, there's no road, right? The red is the New York Central Railroad, right? The dotted line on the bottom one there is actually a proposed trunk sewer that was going to take all the effluent coming from the neighboring communities and channel it, right, and prevent it from being dumped into the stream corridor. There's some local roads shown here, but the thing we all know the Bronx River Parkway for today is, in fact, not there, right? And it's only later, right, that the commission starts distinguishing between this linear park and a parkway drive. Right, and in fact, they basically begin to, this is the 1918 report, so this is quite a bit after the whole thing is launched. The natural charm of the finished parkway will, of course, always be its chief asset, but this asset can only be put to its full benefit and purpose with the completion of this parkway drive, right? This is the first time we're really starting to see a road being introduced here, right? And then this road is going to make the parkway accessible and also furnish some, so there's some discussion of it handling traffic from the crowded city to the open countryside, facilitating the transit out of the city. So the question then becomes, well, how did this parkway, this linear park, become the Bronx River Parkway that we know today? Well, first of all, these men were all, as I said, very wealthy at the top of their society. They were the early adopters of the automobile, right? They all had automobiles. Some of them really took up the automobile with great gusto. This fellow here, William T. Vanderbilt, was a friend of some of these men, as I'll show you in a moment. William T. Vanderbilt actually builds a private parkway for his own use, right? The Long Island Motor Parkway, which I'm sure some of you are familiar with, was built around 1905, 1906. It's essentially a very long driveway that he builds to run his cars between Queens and property that he owns out near Lake, at the shore of Lake Ronkonkoma, right? And there's races, the Vanderbilt Cup race was run for many, many years there and elsewhere. So this is motoring is in the air. This is a new thing. It's taken up very enthusiastically by men in this social class, right? So, but we need a connection to Westchester, and it's Dave Hennen Morris who I think is that connection. This is something I've really uncovered only recently. I guess I haven't found, as an historian, I haven't yet found a smoking gun evidence to back what I'm going to argue here, but if it's not smoking gun evidence, at least the barrel is warm, right? And Dave Hennen Morris, and that actually was his name, Dave, it wasn't David, it was Dave Hennen Morris, also a lawyer. He was actually born in New Orleans, but he was from a very old, distinguished New York family, the Morris family. Morrisiana in the Bronx, Mount Morris Park. This is an old New York fan, Gouverneur Morris. And he's from a very wealthy family, and then he marries a Vanderbilt. So he's pretty well off at this point. He's a close friend of William T. Vanderbilt, the fellow you saw in the previous slide here, and is a major motorist. Right, he's an early advocate of in the Good Roads Movement. The condition of roads and highways lagged tremendously behind motor vehicle technology in the early part of the 20th century. He's one of the real early advocates of building good roads. He's also one of the founders of the American Automobile Association, and he is also good friends with William White Niles, who's also involved with the AAA at its outset. And Niles is actually the one who brings Dave Hennen Morris on board to be one of the commissioners. They both lived in the Bronx. They were both very good friends, and they were both motoring enthusiasts. But it's Hennen Morris's connection to William Vanderbilt that I think introduces the idea of a limited access, grade-separated, high-speed motor road, right, into the Westchester Project, into the Bronx River Stream Reclamation Project, right, because he's familiar with just that in Long Island with Vanderbilt, right, the Long Island Motor Parkway. Long Island Motor Parkway, in some respects, was the first limited-access, grade-separated road in the world. But it was not designed to very high standards, as we'll see in a moment. And it was also private. You know, it wasn't a public road. So I think this bears scrutiny. And in fact, here's a later iteration of the commission, some drawings of the parkway running up through the Bronx there. Now, so how did this all get designed? And how is it that the Bronx River Parkway becomes really the template for every modern highway in the world today? I like to tell my students that there's not a highway in the world that doesn't share some of the DNA of the Bronx River Parkway. This is really where it all begins. It didn't start out that way. In fact, when they decided to build a motor road through this reservation, they turned to, not to somebody with a huge expertise in civil engineering or road design, but a forester and someone who had a moderate amount of landscape architectural experience, but who was part of that crowd and was known well, especially to the New York Zoological and Society and Park, the Bronx Zoo folks. And it was this fellow here, Hermann Merkel. Hermann Merkel was a German-born forester of distinction. He is most well-known, or should be, he's actually not well-known at all, but he should be as the person who first identifies the chestnut blight, right, here in North America. The chestnut blight was, I'm sure most of you know this, but the chestnut blight was a fungal disease that wiped out the American chestnut within about 9 or 10 years. It was one of the biggest catastrophes that ever struck American forestry. The chestnut, American chestnut, was one of our best trees. Not only did it produce mast for wildlife and food, the chestnuts were huge and delicious, but it was an important timber tree, economically important tree, especially in the southeastern United States. But this fungus comes in. It's a very light and easily airborne fungus. So it's unlike Dutch elm disease, right, which comes later and does even greater damage in an urban design aesthetic sense. It's a very light airborne, easily airborne fungal spore, so it spreads very quickly. Anyway, he's the one who first identifies this in trees in the Bronx Zoo and elsewhere in the Bronx. But they need somebody with more expertise here, and it's a fortuitous meeting that draws this gentleman into the story, and me in a certain sense, because Gilmore Clark here was a landscape architect, a graduate of Cornell's early program. It was actually called the Department of Rural Art. It was in the College of it was in the New York State College of Agriculture. Today it's the New York State College of Agriculture and Life Sciences. And I'm sure you know this, or maybe some of you know this, that Cornell is an Ivy League school. Part of it is a private school, but it's also, Cornell is unique in the Ivy League in that, like Kansas State, it's also New York State's land grant institution, right? So we have a huge agricultural school there, and landscape architecture has bounced between the architecture school and the agriculture school several times over the decades. It's a long and not very interesting story, but in any case, Gilmore Clark graduates in 1913 from the landscape program at Cornell, and is basically living back home with mom and dad in the Bronx, getting very involved with the Boy Scout movement. In fact, he founded the Bronx chapter of the Boy Scouts of America. He was giving a lecture on the Boy Scouts, basically for fundraising purposes. And William White Niles happened to be in the audience. And Niles approaches him afterward and basically tells him, we're looking for somebody to design a state-of-the-art motor road through this parkway reservation, through this these lands that we've secured and cleared of all sorts of development to clean up the Bronx River, and he gets the job. Right, this is Cornell. He enters Cornell 1909, and really gets going on this. His position is coordinator of construction. Which is an interesting title, because he's not the project landscape architect of record, but he actually has more authority over the actual alignment and configuration of the road than Herman Merkel does, who is the landscape architect of record. It's also curious historically to note that Frederick Law Olmsted's role initially on the Central Park project was also coordinator of construction before they pulled the plug on the early VL plan and decided to have a competition, which of course Olmsted and Vaux then won. Anyway, this is construction early on. Then World War I breaks out. In fact, the reason he's in a uniform here is because this photo is taken a little bit after the story, and He serves as an engineer with the 3rd Division of the U.S. Army, sees some horrific fighting in France and Belgium during World War I, actually does a little bit of design work there, actually more than a little. He designs a lot of bridges that are part of the effort to get Allied, the Allied Expeditionary Force across the front. develops a really strong interest in bridge design and real expertise in bridge design, which he carries back to Westchester, and you see it expressed in the beautiful bridges that are built over to carry roads over the Bronx River Parkway and other parkways. He also happens to design the patch, this insignia for the 3rd Division, which is still used to this day. You see it there on the lower right. He originally used red and white because he wanted Cornell's colors to be on it. The division commander rejected that and changed it to blue and white because he had graduated from Yale. And nobody knows this in the 3rd Division, but that's why. They're actually carrying around the Yale colors. Nobody realizes that, but and it's still used today. This is the camouflage version of it. Just on a personal note, my grandfather was actually a private in the same unit as Gilmore Clark. I don't think they knew each other, though, but it's ironic that I'm, you know, working on a book about Clark. And anyway, the parkway isn't fully finished until well after the war, until 1922. This is the opening ceremony. That's Madison Grant pontificating there. You can see William White Niles in that boater here. That's Niles. I'm pretty sure this is Jay Downer, who was the original engineer on the project. I'm pretty sure that's Gilmore Clark in the back there. And this is a major piece of infrastructure, really the state of the art in terms of motor vehicle infrastructure in the world, right? It's you see an early view of it here. It doesn't look like a state of the art highway, but it certainly is. It draws from the same sensibilities about design and about space that Olmsted and Vaux used or developed in the design of Central and Prospect Park and Franklin Park, right? This pastoral mode, this attempt to create an idealized nature that would somehow remove you from the city, right? Even though you were in the midst of the city, right? And in a way, the parkway was an extruded form of this, right? It was a long, drawn-out, linear form that created an almost cinematic experience for the driver and passengers, right, as you moved through this corridor, which was not very wide, right? This was mostly stagecraft and illusion, carried off by strategic plantings and a very creative use of earthworks and berms to screen off-site views that would disrupt this pastoral, reverie sense of removal. And it was very effective. And so what you had here was both a very progressive piece of infrastructure, but one that was nostalgic at the same time. Marshall Berman, I think, put it best in his book, All That Is Solid Melts Into Air, a wonderful book about modernity. But he described the parkway as a kind of romantic bower in which modernism and pastoralism could intertwine. There were a number of ways in which this road really set, again, as I suggested a moment ago, set the template for modern highway design. Limited access is one, right? And this is kind of a random shot, but it says limited access. This notion that the road was weaving its way through a corridor, right, and that you didn't have private property owners abutting right up to the road who can punch driveways through and cutouts through or driveway cuts, right? So you had limited access. And then even more important, you had this notion of separation of grade separated traffic. So intervening roads, roads that crossed over, railroads, and other infrastructure, pipelines and such, that were basically lifted above or below so that you had no kind of interference with the flow of traffic here. This was something that Olmsted and Vaux pioneered in Central Park, right? Some feel that they won the competition largely on this idea that the other schemes lacked, but carrying the crosstown traffic under these wonderful underpasses while the park and all its pastoralism and critters are allowed to flow unimpeded overhead. These are still obviously a major part of Central Park today. This fellow is living dangerously on the left there, but I'm sure many of you have been here and know this well. So those are limited access, grade separation. And then the actual configuration of the road itself was a quantum leap ahead of what Vanderbilt had done with the Long Island Motor Parkway. What Clark perfects here, and you see this again and again in many of the roads that he is involved with later on in Westchester County, but also with Robert Moses in New York City, and with his firm Clark and Rapuano elsewhere in the New York metro area, the Palisades Parkway, the Garden State Parkway, and others, right, is this use of these smooth flowing spiral curves, right, an almost endless succession of S-curves, right, that create this effect of, you can almost imagine steering the wheel back and forth gently, gracefully moving through this landscape, right? And this is occurring in two dimensions. It's occurring on the XY as well as the Z axes, right? So he's, even as this is being laid out in plan view, in section two, you've got this S-curve move going on. This is, and if you can imagine trying to get that all working and at the same time bond it to the landscape in a way that avoids massive cuts, massive fills, that allows the road to be laid very lightly on the land. This is really something. This is design. This is artistry in an era, of course, well before we had sophisticated computers to calculate all this. And so these roads are really were at the forefront of highway design. This is a good example of what not to do, right? You could see here, imagine inserting a little straight section at that curve at the left or upper right, and you get what Clark used to refer to as a broken back curve or a flat wheel curve. Imagine a flat section on a railroad wheel, and it's like clacking along the tracks. Another example here is the Merritt Parkway. Merritt Parkway was Clark's favorite whipping boy. He felt that the Merritt Parkway was a very poorly designed parkway, and it is. It's a beautiful parkway because it goes up and down hills and through some wonderful forests, but in terms of roadway design, it doesn't have any of the sophistication of the Bronx River Parkway, or especially the roads that come right after the Bronx River Parkway, also designed by Clark. The Sawmill, the Hutchinson River Parkway, the Cross County Parkway. The Merritt has long straight runs that plunge up and down hills, kind of bottom you out at the bottom, send you flying at the top, send cars skidding off whenever there's a little bit of snow or ice. Really was his favorite example of a bad parkway. He pissed a lot of people off in Connecticut by repeating stories about it. And with these subsequent parkways, the Bronx River doesn't have it because, as you could see in that upper right there, you almost see the cars leaning over. But the Sawmill, Hutchinson, they introduce super elevated turns, right, where you've got banking going on, allows a higher speed of operation. And the parkway, you know, it's hard to imagine a highway project improving conditions for neighborhoods all along the way, raising property values, in turn raising the tax base. Excuse me, but that's exactly what happens in Westchester. In fact, it's so successful that Westchester County goes on a parkway building binge, right? They build all these parkways that I named and more. And this really, again, is Clark's innovation. They begin to see the parkway not as just a means of getting from point A to point B, but as the kind of ligature that can be used to structure something even greater, a region-wide park system, right? And so what Westchester builds, the Westchester County Park Commission, bills in Westchester all through the 1920s, right up into through the crash and even into the early 30s, is the first motor park, the first park system of the motor age, really, right? And this is something that is unprecedented. And here you could see it. You have parks, you have even small county parks, you have forest preserves, you have seaside or waterfront parks like Glen Island Park, the first and only municipal amusement park in the country, Rye Playland down right on the border in White Plains on the border of the Bronx. And these are all woven together, all held together into this larger structure of this region-wide park system. And this is studied by planners, municipal officials, civil engineers from all over the world, right? I've seen evidence of parkway design in Nanjing in China that draws from the people come from China to study, from Australia, from Germany. In fact, that example of the broken back curve I showed earlier was actually one of the early Berlin Autobahn, which were based largely on the Westchester parkways, not the other way around, as it's often mistakenly surmised. As far as the United States, though, The most enthusiastic adopter of the Westchester model, as it was often framed, was the gentleman on the right here, who's Robert Moses. Moses actually met Clark very early on in the early 20s when Clark was working on the Bronx River Parkway. He actually tries to recruit him later on to head up the Long Island State Park work that Moses undertakes in the mid-1920s. He turns that job offer down, but ends up consulting with Moses for Moses on a number of projects, including Jones Beach State Park, which is still the crown jewel of the Long Island State Park system. He also helps design the Southern State Parkway and the Northern State Parkway on Long Island, both of which are modeled almost exactly on the Hutchinson and Sawmill Parkway. And what you have emerging here between Clark and Moses is really a relationship very similar in many ways to that which developed between Eugene Hausmann, who you see in cartoon form on the left here, and his right-hand man, his landscape architect, chief landscape architect and civil engineer, Adolf Alfond, when Hausmann was carrying out these extraordinary urban renewals of Paris in the Second Empire period, in the 1850s and 60s. A very similar relationship develops between Moses and Clark. And this is work that you see, or a relationship that you see expressed in many ways throughout New York City in the second half of the 1930s. When LaGuardia won the 1933 election, becomes mayor in early 1934, it's a fusion government. Fiorello LaGuardia is an extraordinary mayor, I think the greatest mayor New York's ever had, New York City. And he is the one who brings Robert Moses on as park commissioner. And Moses accepts the position on the condition that he be commissioner of the entire New York City parks system, not just Manhattan. Previously, each borough had their own park commissioner. Moses gets his way with LaGuardia, as he often did, and becomes New York City's first citywide commissioner. It's Moses who then turns around, brings Clark down from Westchester as his park design czar, in effect. And Clark, in turn, brings half of his office staff down to New York. And remember, as I said earlier, Westchester County was the state-of-the-art producer of public works infrastructure in North America at the time, right? They had some of the best engineers, landscape architects, urban planners working in America at the time. It was the most sought after job in those fields in many ways, especially for public works. So they had a lot of expertise on staff there. The whole first generation of highway designers in the United States were basically trained at Clark's elbow in Westchester. And you had roads like the Mount Vernon Expressway, the Blue Ridge Parkway, and other early highways that were designed either by Clark as a consultant or by his acolytes. Right, so this is a tremendous amount of expertise that is now down in New York City. You can see the main characters here, Moses Clark. Michael Rapuano was Clark's understudy and his most prized designer, who actually did a lot of the design work. He was another Cornell grad from the landscape architecture program, won a Rome Prize in landscape architecture, and becomes really the chief designer of a lot of these parks in this period. The two of them form a partnership later on, Gilmore Clark and Michael Rapuano. Among their projects, the site plan for the 1939 New York World's Fair, the site plan and planting plans for 11 of these great public pools that were all opened in one summer, in the summer of 1936, site plan for the United Nations headquarters, for JFK Airport, for dozens of public housing and urban renewal projects, both good, bad, and ugly. Cadman Plaza there too. They're also the conduits, especially Rapuano, of the reason why the London Plane tree is the iconic, most numerous tree in New York City. Right? It is largely Mike Rapuano's doing. He encounters this tree. For those of you who've been to Rome, you know that the London Plane is actually one of the most common trees in the city of Rome, right? Respighi and his Pines of Rome aside, Rome is really a city of plane trees. I wrote a piece about this a couple of years ago for the Wall Street Journal. And it's Rapuano who brings this idea back. This is why many of the parks that you see in New York City are still dominated by London planes, and often planted in that dense grid-like pattern that you see in places like here, like this, the Red Hook swimming pool here in Brooklyn, right? This grid, this boschetti of, this is straight from Rome. It's actually from the Villa Aldobrandini outside of Rome that Rapuano studies. And you see it again and again at Cadman Plaza there. If any of you have been to Cadman Plaza, you know it's a grid of plane trees in the New York City. To this day, the New York City Parks Department logo is actually a leaf, a London plane tree. Leaf, it's not a maple leaf. I'm always correcting people on this. It's a London plane leaf. But really what I want to get back to here is roads. These guys, Clark and Rapuano, become the major designers and planners of parkways during the Moses years, and are involved with many of these major arterials in the city. The Grand Central Parkway here, for example. Many of these roads, I need to point this out because it's one thing that Robert Caro doesn't do as to the degree that I think would have been worth doing in The Power Broker, is that many of the roads that Moses is credited with conceiving and certainly and justifiably of building were actually projected and proposed many, many years earlier by Thomas Adams and the Regional Plan Association of New York. And you see Thomas Adams here. Many of the roads in this drawing here are roads that Moses eventually builds. You've got the Southern State, the Northern State, the Grand Central, right, the Henry Hudson, and others. In any case, that's something of an aside. These roads that are built in the early years of the Moses, Clark, and Rapuano collaboration, and I'm talking 34 to 39, 40 really is the main era. These are some of the best examples of the highway and the city coming together in unison, in harmony, right? And it's an all too fleeting moment, of unfortunately. But here you see one of the best examples. This is the Henry Hudson Parkway. These are the magnificent Beaux-Arts-style watercolor renderings that Mike Rapuano did of the project. This involved also a massive upgrading and restoration of Riverside Park, which was an Olmsted Vaux project, but really had fallen into ruin, and is redesigned by Clark and especially Rapuano. These drawings, by the way, are just a small piece of a 12-foot-long series of massive watercolor renderings. Really some of the most beautiful renderings I've ever seen. This is 79th Street here coming into the Henry Hudson, and you can see the roundabout there, which still exists today. It's the 79th Street Boat Basin is right here. This roundabout actually it engages the 79th Street into the highway, into the Henry Hudson Parkway here. This cloverleaf form here, these are actually not this is not roadbed. These are actually pedestrian paths here, sidewalks, right? And so what I'm getting at here is that in this early stage of the urban highway, you really had an extraordinary effort to make these, to humanize this infrastructure, right? To provide a range of amenities for people without cars, for people on foot, right? For people living in the neighborhoods nearby. And again, this is unfortunately a fleeting moment, but it's one that's left us with a wonderful legacy, in at least in New York City. And you see also all sorts of parks, playgrounds, ball fields, tennis courts, right? Small playgrounds like this all along the way that were part of the highway project, part of the Henry Hudson Parkway, right? A lot of this infrastructure still exists. If any of you have been to Riverside Park recently, you know that a lot of this is still here. And there's, again, Rapuano's insistent Boschetti of London Plains, the little gridded forest. Here's another view. There's that. And what did they place in the circle there is this extraordinary fountain and courtyard. This, for years, this was in very bad shape. It was actually a very dangerous place to go when I was a kid and a teenager, but it's been all restored. There's now a cafe and restaurant in here. It's one of the most heavily used public spaces in this part of the city now. The fountain is still being restored, I think. But elsewhere in the city, too, it wasn't just the Henry Hudson. The Bell Parkway, for example, in Brooklyn, running through around the edge of like Bay Ridge and Sheepshead Bay, Marine Park, into Queens, also brought along with it a wide array of amenities for people along the way. And Moses is insistent about this. There are letters that I've found in the Moses papers at the New York Public Library where he's admonishing his designers for not including enough playgrounds and amenities and walkways and bridle paths and bike paths along the way. Right, he sees these as not just motorways, but as long linear parks. Right, and I've actually written about this elsewhere, that Robert Moses really builds the most miles of bike path in New York City. No one's built more before or since. It's not something we associate with Moses, because in the post-war version, Moses really becomes a demon of sorts. And all the good that he does goes out the window. He does things like refuse, for no good reason except his own obstinacy, refuses to build a bikeway on the Verrazano Bridge, for example, which we're still struggling to deal with, right? But in an earlier phase, he was all about that. And here's another example. This is really one of the last examples, is the Brooklyn-Queens Expressway. Now, we're already out of the parkway mode here. This begins right before World War II and is not completed until several years after World War II. And we're already moving into a whole different sensibility here. Post-war America, the notion about sashaying your way leisurely through the landscape in a motor car is already passé, right? It's just get me to where I'm going as fast as possible, as efficiently as possible. I don't want any bullshit along the way. Just move me there, right? There's this culture of efficiency and speed is really in place. It's like we're all racing to something, racing the Soviets to the moon, the Cold War, but this is the last and really in some ways greatest example of that old idea of the humanized highway. And it happens largely because you had a group of individuals here, a community that banded together and had the political connections and the money to force Moses to play nice, right? And this is Brooklyn Heights, still then as now a very affluent community, basically forced Moses to create this extraordinary triple-deck cantilevered structure to carry the Brooklyn Queens Expressway around the neighborhood rather than plowing through the neighborhood as he had done in the poorer neighborhoods to the south and as he would do soon after this to working class neighborhoods to the north, right? And builds also wonderful playgrounds here, ball courts, and other infrastructure for folks living in the neighborhood. But it's this structure here that I want to focus on. I don't know how many of you have been to Brooklyn Heights, but you know if you have been, the top deck here, the top tray is the Brooklyn Heights Promenade. It's to this day one of the great open spaces in New York City. And the lower two trays carry the different lanes, the north and southbound lanes of the BQE around around Brooklyn Heights, Columbia Heights. This is what it looks like up top, right? It's an extraordinary structure that Michael Rapuano was involved in conceiving. He's not the designer of record, but he was very involved. They were the designers of the actual top promenade part, but there's a lot of evidence suggesting that Rapuano was the person who suggested using this notion of terracing into the hillside with these cantilevered trays. And the reason is that Rapuano had a lot of expertise in the architectonics of steeply sloping sites, steep-sloped sites. When he was a fellow at the American Academy in Rome and pre-World War II, the fellows at the Academy had to produce these exquisite measured drawings of some of the great villas and piazzas in Italy. He chooses the most difficult one of all. It's the Villa d'Este in Tivoli, just outside of Rome. Some of you may know the Villa d'Este. It's a real masterpiece, and it is built into a very steep sloped site, right? And there's these great viewing terraces and platforms and a kind of cat's cradle of paths and terraces that work their way down the hill. And he had spent two or three years measuring every, you know, brick and corner of this place and knew it very well. So this is the last great moment of humanistic highway design in metropolitan New York. What happens after this is things fall apart very quickly. Motor vehicle registrations, even before World War II, are skyrocketing. You look at the numbers on the right here, you can see even into the 20s, right before the crash, the numbers are going up. By 1939, this is the New York World's Fair, 1939-1940, right? We know about the Trilon and Perisphere and all that, but we forget that the motor car was already a major part of life and landscape in New York City by 1939, as this parking lot suggests. And also inside the Perisphere, right, inside that orb up top in the center there, you had Norman Bel Geddes' magnificent, in an evil way, magnificent projection of the future American landscape, right, with these super blocks and skyscrapers I can't even count how many lanes are there. It's like a 10-lane expressway. And look, the one on the upper right, you know, makes Houston look dense and walkable in comparison. So this was already in place. And in the post-war years, it's it really spirals out of control, so that we have the enthusiasm and wonderment expressed by that hapless young woman on the right for this new infrastructure, which, as you all know, does enormous damage to our cities, and these desperate, increasingly desperate attempts on the parts of, like, the downtown business community here on the left to somehow lure the middle class that is increasingly fleeing to the suburbs back downtown, to the point where I love this drawing because it renders the city as little more than parking opportunity, right? So figure ground, you've got other buildings there in the dark blocks, but then look at what's already been cleared to make way for, and this gets more and more absurd, right, as the years go by. You've got things like this proposal here for weaving an expressway into and through buildings. Could you imagine this today with our concerns about terrorism and security? Or on the right, these desperate attempts to drag the pastoral experience of driving through the landscape that we had with the early parkways, insisting that we must have this even in the city itself. This is actually an example from Baltimore, but you have in that trench there, this is an excavated trench below grade, but you've got this insistence on planting it and sashaying your way through as if this is a road through the open countryside, right? And this is actually an example that's not built, but it's, you can see that we've gotten really carried away here, and it's really no longer viable. And of course, we have ultimately with projects like the Gowanus Expressway, and especially again the cross Brooklyn Queens Expressway, all the old sensibilities about creating roads that brought to the neighboring communities all sorts of amenities, this is really dropped, right? And so in the post-war period, this is what we get. This is in the Red Hook section of Brooklyn, right? Just plowing right through, right down Hicks Street here. The Cross Bronx Expressway, of course, does a similar thing in across parts of the Bronx. And this is the ruination of these neighborhoods, right? In example after example, you have, it starts with the Gowanus. This is very well documented in Caro's book, The Power Broker. The coming of this expressway here, and this is, you know, this is a very heroic rendering of it. In other sections, it's a third of that or an eighth of that height and really looks more like this. Here, and this is not something that makes for a wonderful neighborhood. It really triggered a very rapid downward spiral. The neighborhood in Sunset Park that the Gowanus goes through was once a very vital and very vibrant Scandinavian community. It was mostly Swedes and Norwegian immigrants, lots of mom and pop shops and stores and restaurants. Within 2 or 3 years after the project began, the people just left and the place was just abandoned and is undergoing a cycle of blight. And this happens in the Bronx, as is also well documented in Robert Caro's book. This is an aerial photo of downtown Brooklyn in the 1920s. This is what it looks like. By 1955 or 51 maybe, you could see the clearing for the expressway on the left and all the clearing for various urban renewal projects. And the combined effect of urban renewal, which I won't even get into here, and the expressway building really guts city after city in the United States. This is the BQE marching its way through Williamsburg. And again, it's almost like, you know, Sherman marching to the sea here during the Civil War. This is Boston in the 1920s. This is Boston, same view essentially with the combined effects of urban renewal for Government Center, for the West End, and this massive bit of plumbing here, which is the central artery. This road, which is punched through in the 50s, this is now, I'm sure you all know, is now underground. And the early plans were to infill that gash. That never happened. Now we have the Rose Kennedy Greenway, that's nice and green and birds and all, but it's still doing the same thing in effect. It's still a gap in the fabric. We should have infilled it a lot more, but that's another story. So I'll leave you with this because this is the tragic end, really, of this whole story that that began so with such high ambitions. Even if those ambitions were wrapped up in some of the less savory aspects of the conservation movement. And it's not until recently that that we've begun to recover from a lot of the damage that was done in this period. Now, you know, these days we're wrestling with a different set of problems. We have a dilemma of abundance in a sense, in the sense that we've defeated a lot of bad projects, right? The Lower Manhattan Expressway, the Mid-Manhattan Expressway in New York, defeated in large measure by the advocacy of Jane Jacobs and others. And the anti-highway, anti-expressway movement, anti-freeway movements in various parts of the United States were very effective in ending the tyranny of the highway builders, the tyranny that was begun by folks like Robert Moses. San Francisco, very ably fights back after this plan on the left was leaked to the press and creates a real storm of protest in San Francisco. In Boston, there are several major roads, the Inner Belt, the Southwest Expressway, that are defeated, that would have gutted parts of Cambridge. The Inner Belt would have marched right through Central Square and Cambridgeport and parts near MIT. And that was fought very successfully by a banding together of local folks led by some MIT professors. This is actually a mural right near Memorial Drive that commemorates the Inner Belt Project. Southwest Corridor, it becomes a park after the Southwest Expressway was defeated. And you all know today, you all and your peers at Cornell and in other schools, you are interested in cities, thank God. There is a great urban revival underway. It brings its own set of problems. We've got, you know, limited housing stock that's leading to gentrification and such and so forth. But I think the days of urban abandonment are certainly behind us. Hopefully the automobile will continue to be put in its place and replaced by public transit and people on foot. Any questions? Yes. Well, Brasilia comes a bit later. Brasilia really is a high modernist exercise, design and planning exercise. I'm not sure there's any kind of influence on these. Are you talking about the influence of these road projects on Brasilia, on the design?
So the design of Brasilia, several of the roads in Brasilia are very direct.
Right.
The sort of sinuosity, these continuous circles that go around and around the city. I don't know if there was any influence.
Yeah, I don't know. That's a good question. Certainly Brasilia was designed not with the pedestrian mind. It is the antithesis of a walkable city. It was very much designed at the apex of that idea that we all were going to be in cars and love it, and we were going to drive everywhere, and you know, the whole sensibility that led to suburbanization or helped facilitate suburbanization, and that we're struggling to fix today. So in that sense, yeah, there was a strong element of influence from I would say more the post-World War II iteration of the American highway. As far as the squiggly stuff on the, I'm not familiar with that. It's possible that there was some influence from the earlier parkway models, but I'm not sure. It could be. I know the site for Brasilia was actually selected by a Cornell geographer. Actually, what was his name? Donald. I'm spacing on his name now, but he was actually one of the pioneers of GIS and taught in the urban planning program, city planning program at Cornell. So who knows, maybe there was some connection between Clark's tenure there and... No questions? Follow me on Twitter. I'm at Built Brooklyn, and it's not just about Brooklyn. I tweet about my cat, too. No, I tweet about a lot of urban-related, city-related, architecture-related things. Yeah?
I have a question for you about the areas underneath Elevated Express.
Yeah.
And the question is predicated on former residents in New Orleans.
Yeah.
Where I lived in close proximity to the raised I-10.
Yeah.
And when I first moved there, I thought, oh, this is a hideous eyesore. The I-10 destroyed this historic neighborhood.
Yeah.
But the reality is, for people who live there today, it's a gathering spot.
Interesting.
For festivals, yeah. For old men to tell stories.
Yeah.
And I wonder if you have encountered any examples of these underneath areas of elevated expressways that have been rehabbed in an aesthetically pleasing way to both reconcile the present and the past.
Right. Yeah, there are examples. I've seen in other countries, I've seen in a number of Chinese cities where those spaces underneath are used by, you know, all sorts of groups. There's one, this was a while ago now, but in Guangzhou, under one of the early elevated expressways, they were all, you know, one of the things that's not so great about the elevated road is that it creates a kind of desert underneath. You have almost no rainfall, so it's very dry and dusty. But you can put things there that would otherwise be damaged by water. So in Guangzhou, and this is going back 20 years or so, I remember they had an array. I don't know who had put them there. I assume the city. But there were about 15 or 20 pool tables in not very great condition, but they were all underneath, basically following the footprint of the road. And people would, you know, there were dozens of people playing pool there. I've also... But in the American context, I haven't seen too much of that. When did you see this in New Orleans? Recently? Yeah, that's interesting. New Orleans, by the way, New Orleans was, you know, one of the things Robert Moses did during World War II, because he had been turned down from helping with the war effort by FDR. He and FDR didn't get along at all, and that too relates to parkways, because they first got to know each other when FDR was chairman of the Taconic State Parkway Commission. The Taconic State Parkway is the northward extension of the Bronx River Parkway. And they were constantly at each, there was a, you know, two huge egos together is not a good thing. And then when he was governor, later on, they fought. So Moses needed something else to do during the war, and what he did was he toured the country. He went on basically a Moses tour, and carried his gospel of urban expressways and modernist urbanism all around the country, and did consult these planning reports for a number of cities, several of which were authored by and actually written by Clark and Rapuano and some of these other engineers and architects who were very involved with his projects. Madigan Highland, Ernest Clark was another fellow who was very involved. And New Orleans was one of these. They did planning reports for Flint, Michigan, for Portland, Oregon, I think for Baltimore, and other cities. But as far as the elevate, you know, there's a new book that you might want to look at if you haven't seen. It's called Under the L, and it was published by the New York City DOT. With a lot of input from folks from the Cornell City and Regional Planning Department's New York City studio. We have a studio in Lower Manhattan, and we're involved with this too. I have an essay in there as well. It's called Under the Elevated. One of the things I've always appreciated about elevated rail lines, elevated subways, is that they don't create that total darkness, that total perpetual shade that the roadbed does, because you've got the ties and you've got the light coming through, and you've got water and rain coming through. The ecosystem under the elevated subways is a wonderful one, actually. I think the quality of light is almost like that of in a forest. It's like this filtered, dappled light. But the roads had a very different effect. So in Brooklyn, BQE, Gowanus, I never see anything more than parked cars and pigeon shit in those spaces. I hate to say it. Yeah.
The talk by discussing how the racialist thinking of Madison Grant viewed with the early era of parkway design. Yeah. To what extent was that racist thinking an explicit part of the second generation of highway design post-war?
That's a great question. It wasn't explicitly, but its effects were even more dramatic. I would say the effects of those, the construction of those roads, had a very unequal effect in the city in terms of race, right? And you saw this a bit with the BQE. You know, these roads were not routed through affluent neighborhoods if they could avoid it, right? The taking costs were enormous. The political problems were huge. Right. In fact, one of the reasons why the BQE was so amenity impoverished all along its route is because everything went in to satisfy the noisy affluent Brooklyn Heights community. Right. And that cantilever, you know, that has to be rebuilt in the next few years. And you wait and see how expensive it's going to be. This cost a fortune to build that, right? And it sucked all the resources out of the other places. But they had to go through there. They had no choice. They had to go through that. Elsewhere, these roads were routed quite deliberately through the poorest neighborhoods. And whether they were white working class, white ethnic neighborhoods, or later on, more commonly, African American neighborhoods, the impacts that they had, these roads had, were huge and disproportionate. So in a sense, the racism of the early era kind of carried through in a very different form, not clearly connected, but perhaps on a larger metaphysical plane, it certainly was expressed. Yeah.
Was the Bronxburg Parkway successful in cleaning the Bronxburg?
Yes. Yeah, very much so. Mainly because, not because they added a road. In fact, the road kind of eventually dumped more poisons into the waterway. But the main reason is because part of the project involved building a trunk sewer. And so the effluent that was going into the river, all the sewer discharge was not going into the waterway anymore. It was being channeled and treated. So yeah, they did clean up the river, that's for sure. Any other questions? Thank you very much for coming. Nice big crowd.